Well, good morning, everybody. Good to see you. How'd y'all crawl out of bed this morning? Boy, I had to scrape the ice off the car, you know, and warm it up for about 45 minutes before I could make it here today. Hope y'all are doing real well. Lisa, you have an announcement for us?
Can you all hear me okay?
Sure, we can.
Oh, good. I am just excited to bring back to you that we went to our Children's Pastors Conference this past week with our nursery coordinator, Sue Ellen Grubbs,
Bob.
And I, and we were just so filled with so much wonderful information to bring back to our children and to you all. So stay tuned. We'll have more to share about that through time. We also have our Founders Day celebration coming up. And that is February 19th. And at our 9:30 service, our children are going to be participating in the program. And if you have any grandchildren or neighbors with children that would love to be a part of it, they're welcome to join us anytime. And we'd love to have them come over and see us for Sunday school. We have a women's Bible study also, and it is tomorrow night, and we've only watched the first video. And we will do one session for two weeks. So we're just about to discuss the video. So if you missed us last Monday, you're welcome to join us at 7 p.m. It is Priscilla Shire's Armor of God. And it is going to be, it is just fabulous already for us women who have been. It's just been wonderful. So come join us tomorrow night at 7 o'clock in the Fellowship Hall, which is the building right outside these double doors on that side. Also, we are working to put a children's library in each classroom, and our kids are pre-K through fifth grade, and maybe you have some books that just been sitting on the shelf that are children's books that you've just not known what to do with. We are looking for Christian children's books to share with our children. They can check them out and bring them back when they're done. So if you have a used book or possibly you're at the Christian bookstore and see a sale or something that just touches your heart for a child to read, please donate to us. We would love to have it. And we're doing that through March so then we can get it all put together. And you can donate them in the parlor that's just past the restrooms in this hallway on that big table. Or you can bring them over to me at the children's area straight through these double doors into the next building. So we look forward to bringing you more information on everything we've learned at our Children's Pastors Conference, and I thank you again for your support in the children's ministry.
Lisa Greeno, ladies and gentlemen, Lisa Greeno. Actually, she wasn't telling you the truth. The reason you're to bring in those children's books is so I'll have something to read at my level. How y'all doing today anyway? Okay. Well, Heavenly Father, we've walked into your house. Now then, help us to lay it down. Leave it alone. Boy, now, Lord, we want to worship you. We want to praise you. We want to express our love and appreciation and our gratitude for all the things that you do for us. You're so wonderful. You're so loving. And you're so good to each and every one of us. So on behalf of all these dear, beautiful children of yours, I say thank you. And Father, here we've come to worship you. In Christ's name, amen. All right, now the scripture reading for today. Now, I've divided the scripture reading up versus the text for today. The text is always the Bible story that we're going to do that day, right? But the scripture reading. This is from the Lord Jesus, and he's going to be teaching. He's going to be teaching something totally different. But yet, the biblical principles that come from this scripture reading are going to tie into our text. So, nobody can sleep yet. It's too soon to go to sleep. Sermon's not here yet, so... And if you guys start getting a little warm in here, we got to open the doors so you get some fresh air, what have you. Our scripture reading is taken from John chapter 3, verses 16 to 20 and verse 36. Hear the Lord Jesus. God so loved the world, everybody in the world, that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in Christ shall not perish but have eternal life. For God did not send His Son into the world to judge the world. God didn't come in. He didn't send Jesus Christ to judge you, knock you down, throw you over, and tell you about how bad you are. He didn't do that. So y'all don't do that to yourselves either. God did not send His Son into the world to judge the world, but that the world might be saved through Him. Whoever believes in Jesus Christ is not judged. Whoever does not believe has been judged already, because he has not believed in the name of the only begotten Son of God. This is the judgment, that the light has come into the world, and men love the darkness rather than the light, for their deeds were evil. Now everyone who does evil hates the light and does not come to the light for fear their deeds will be exposed. Whoever believes in the Son has eternal life, but whoever does not obey the Son will not see life, but rather the wrath of God abides on him. Boy, it's so sobering. So you say, well, why did Jesus come? Boy, he came to offer us grace and mercy and salvation, didn't he? Well, Dave, what are you talking about? How about those people who don't receive the gospel? Well, they've chosen. I'm talking about those who have been able to hear the word cognitively, intellectually, emotionally, spiritually. They've been able to hear it, but they've rejected it. Boy, and they judge themselves. And instead of having the great, wonderful peace of God that passes all understanding, oh, the wrath of God, which is there to draw them to the cross. Amen and amen. Good to see you. Now stand up and let's all sing and have a party. Come on.
Jesus, I'm alive. shout your praise. Our hearts will cry, these bones will sing. Great are you, Lord. And all the earth will shout your praise. Our hearts will cry, these bones will sing. Great are you, Lord. And all the earth will shout.
Oh, please be seated. Please be seated. Ushers, would you please come forward as we will receive the Lord's tithes and our offerings.
I'd like to take a moment before we sing to introduce Kyle Berger. Kyle has joined our team. He is traveling, are working here, and like me, his family, half his family's in another state, so he's going through some of the same things, and he's a wonderful singer, and before I even took this job, I remember praying, Lord, please bring me who you want, who you will, and we've been blessed with Bob and Kyle, and of course Don, awesome, was here before I ever got here, and so I just appreciate these guys. So just wanted to see it.
The sun refused to shine.
Yeah, now. Boy, it doesn't get any better than doo-wop, shoo-wop, huh? Y'all stand up and greet one another this morning. That was... And furthermore, y'all sit down now. Get out your old Bibles now. Come on. Open them up. We're going to be in John chapter 8 today, but before we get there, I need to kind of give you the setting for the message today. Actually, it's the Bible story for today. Just listen. Don't turn. It's in Luke chapter 8, verse 1, but don't go there. I'll be finished by the time you turn there. Listen carefully. The Lord Jesus is going about proclaiming the gospel. He's going about from village to village preaching. And along with Jesus are the 12 disciples with some women who have been healed of evil spirits and sicknesses, such as Mary Magdalene, from whom 7 demons gone out, Joanna, the wife of Cusa, Susanna, and many women were contributing to their support out of their own private means. Today we're going to be focusing. Now you boys don't go to sleep. Now you got to listen. Got to think about this. There was a tremendous entourage of women that went along with Jesus. Y'all always think it's just Jesus and the boys, don't you? Well, who do you think made that cornbread and beans for them? So here we go. I want you to know this is a happy company of companions. There is, with righteous women, there is safety, there is security, and there's always joy when you've got a bunch of good gals around you. Now, come on, fellas. Go ahead. You can clap. Give it up. Come on, boys. I have someone in the balcony who is taking notes on which man didn't clap, and we'll be seeing you after the service. Well, our Bible story starts in John chapter 8, and it's going to be verses 2 through 12. So let's pick it up. Get with me. Here we go. Now, it was early in the morning when Jesus went into Jerusalem, and he went up into the temple. And you got to remember, he's taking his disciples, and that's just not the 12. Well, it's all these women. It's all these other people. And they're going up into the portico of Solomon so they can go up there. And Jesus went up to the temple during the Feast of Tabernacles, or the Feast of Booths. And all the people were coming to Jesus. Boy, when he teaches, boy, we hear that the Master is teaching down there at John's Pass. How fast can you get up here and get down there? Well, the Master's teaching. Boy. So Jesus sat down, and he began to teach, and he's been teaching all morning. He's been contrasting the darkness of the evil that is in human hearts and how the Lord Jesus Christ is the light of the world, who offers salvation to all who would acknowledge him as Savior and repent. Now then, in this temple area, there are what we call the court of women. It'd be something like this. Up here is the Holy of Holies. Here's the holy place, and only the priests could come in here. And then you have the court of the men. And then beyond that, that's where y'all sit. The court of the women. Women can't come up here. Now, any and everybody can go back there and be in the court of women. So there's a great mob. There's a great sea of people that's gathered all around. And here it is where we pick it up. Verse 3. Now the scribes and the Pharisees, they brought a woman caught in adultery and set her in the center of the court of women in the temple. With all these people gathered all around. Why'd they do that? It should have been a private conversation. These scribes and Pharisees, we've already talked about them. They called themselves completely perfect ones according to the law and according to their interpretation of the law, how they lowered the standard saying, yes, we can keep the law perfectly. There's something right about us, something wrong with you. These completely perfect ones see themselves as enforcers of the law. And it is this motley crew. Let me tell you what it is in the Greek. They violently throw this woman to the ground at Jesus' feet. There's no excuse for that. I don't care what you do. That sticks in my craw. I don't like it. Rude behavior. Unacceptable. Most poor woman. Imagine how she felt. Should have been a private conversation. Verse 4, but the scribes and the Pharisees, they threw down on this woman. And this woman, she was accused. Teacher, this woman has been caught in the very act of adultery. What? You mean that's worse if she gets caught? Is this some kind of dramatic thing that, oh, I've got to do some greater penalty or something? Now, I don't understand why these brutes brought this woman to Jesus. He had absolutely no legal authority to judge this woman. He did morally, but we've already read what Jesus does. He doesn't judge. What does he do? He offers forgiveness and love and salvation to those who would repent, don't we? The scribes and the Pharisees, they challenge Jesus in verse 5. Well, Jesus, in the law, Moses commanded us. I don't know how many were there. We're only talking about a few men who took up this woman and brought her in publicly and disgraced her and shamed her. Well, I'll tell you, it's abuse. It's a violation of humanity. So they say, the law has commanded us to stone such women. What do you say, teacher? Well, the scribes and the Pharisees, they said this to test Jesus so they may have grounds to condemn him of breaking the Mosaic law. So that they, in essence, what they're trying to do is they're trying to just get where they can kill Jesus. Now, there's something definitely wrong. Boy, there's parts of this puzzle that bothered me. I had to ask myself some questions. In the Greek, it says this woman was caught in adultery. So, boy, I had to go out. What do you mean by adultery? And you people say, oh, Dave, you that dumb? I go, no, I want to look it up and see what it is. That actually, it's a euphemism. It means that this is a prostitute. and she's guilty of committing adultery. But where's the man? Come on, girls, say, "Preach it, Dave." Well, the law requires both offenders to be tried. How is it that, now watch it, these men are just the few. I don't know how many there are. 2, 3, 5, I don't know. The scribes and Pharisees, these men. Well, how is it that they found this woman? How'd they come upon her? What are they doing in that part of town? How is it that they came into? Now, if you were in Texas, I would do this. I can't do it because you're in Florida. So these men come into Madam Orr's. Let me try to make you feel a little more comfortable. There isn't one person in here who hasn't lusted in your heart after somebody. Now, give it up. We're in good company. So let's not be tough here. All right. Why this woman? How come she wasn't taken to the Jewish authorities? And they in turn would have taken her to the Roman magistrate. Not Jesus. He has no legal right to condemn her. Jesus sees through their ruse. And at this point, I've got to kind of pause here. I'm trying to give some emphasis here. Jesus stooped down on the ground and he wrote something on the ground. I think he was doing nothing more than doodling. I think he's buying time. Well, and I like that too. I like it that Jesus had to stop and think. Well, these people, they want a cut and dry answer. Tell me what the law says. Come on, give it up. What's the law? Watch his response. Well, now let's see. I'm doodling here, and I go, first of all, my goodness, I wonder what this dear woman's going to hear. I know about those Jaspers, those Pharisees and scribes. What about my disciples? What are they going to hear? When I give this answer, what is the crowd going to hear? He has to think. All right. How can I speak to these cold, dead hearts of these accusers? The silence is deafening. It's uncomfortable. It's annoying. Everyone is so quiet you could hear yourself sweat. And when the scribes and the Pharisees, they persisted, they pushed him. Come on, man, give us an answer. Jesus straightened up and he said to them. Now you got to listen to the pronouns here. Jesus says, "He," he's talking about these few, "He who is without sin," that doesn't mean generic sin, "He who is without sin among you, let him be the first to throw a stone at this woman." Let me translate that for you. If you are sinless of this crime yourselves, and if you, perfect ones, believe that you are within your legal and moral authority, kill her. Listen, y'all got to get this. You can't sit down and read the Bible like it's Reader's Digest. It's a bunch of words that express human emotion. Let me tell you something about this. The Jewish law clearly stated that the ones who had discovered this adultery, they were the ones who were to carry out the penalty. If they themselves were not guilty of the same sin. Where'd they find her? Don't we call that the red light district? Y'all better get off your religious high horses now and get down to reality of life. What are these boys doing? Man, I tell you, if they would have thrown a stone at that woman, these men know that they would have been guilty of murder because they have committed the same crime. Again, Jesus stooped down on the ground and he wrote. I have no idea what he's doing. Now then, it's time for these men to think. Oh my goodness. These men, they know they are guilty of misinterpreting the law. Moses commanded us. Who's us? Well, us religious perfect ones. Commanded us to stone such women, only women. Well, we know that's wrong. They knew it. The crowd knew it. The woman knew it. Jesus knew it. Everybody knew what it said. Now, by the way, stoning had been outlawed by the Roman government. Couldn't do it. Misinterpret the Word of God. That's enough to get you in trouble, right? Now then, you're trying to break a Roman law. These men, they know they're guilty. They have been publicly exposed for committing the same crime. And the scribes and the Pharisees, they know they are guilty because they were taking the law into their own hands. And these law enforcers are nothing more than law breakers participating in an illegal trial. Whoa. Verse 9. So when the scribes and the Pharisees heard Jesus' word, they began to leave, sort of slip off, one by one, beginning with the older ones. Let me tell you about these older ones, you people that are my age. Of course, nobody's my age. You know what these guys are doing? I don't know if they were out there at Trixie's place. But boy, I'll tell you, sometime in their life they were. And they're still under the pressure of that shame, of that guilt that they did back then. You know what they're doing? They're projecting their own shame and sin onto this woman. And they want to have her tried and her beat up and her abused. And somehow that would assuage their heart. Somehow they'll make everybody think, well, they're righteous. My God, it makes you sick at your stomach. Y'all ever did? Not you, of course. I'm not talking to you, but through you to somebody out there. Well, let's see, where am I? Jesus' answer has compelled the scribes and the Pharisees to examine their own sinful behavior. These hypocritical, self-righteous, guiltless ones peel off and they leave unrepentant and unforgiven. But wait. Jesus pleads, well, don't leave. Boys, don't go. Now come. I can forgive you. I love you. We've all done wrong. We've all done bad stuff. Come back. Come back. I can make you white as snow. Well, I can purify. Wasn't to be. These hard-hearted, cold men crawl back into that hole. So verse 9, this woman, don't know her name, this woman is left alone with Jesus in the center of the court of women. And there are people all around. And Jesus has a private conversation with this woman. Y'all ever had a private conversation in a big crowd and a bunch of people all around? Boy, sometimes that's the best place to have a quiet, private conversation, isn't it? Yeah, where Jesus is. It's always safe. Standing up, well, the master, he said to her privately, compassionately, so loving, so gently, "Oh, woman, where are your accusers? Did no one condemn you?" And this woman said, "No one, sir." Jesus said, "I do not condemn you either." That's not in Scripture, what I'm about to say. I'm interjecting it. But they're having a private conversation. "I don't condemn you, woman." Now, don't you know that the Lord Jesus gave her the gospel message right then and there? Oh. And he said to her, and this takes us back to our first reading, "God did not send his Son to judge you, dear woman, but that you might be saved through him." Don't you dare misunderstand me. This woman has earned the death penalty. According to Jewish law, she's guilty. Listen, before you can be forgiven, you have to acknowledge your guilt. Oh, but Jesus, he loves this woman so. So he has to whisper to her so nobody can hear, "Your sins are not beyond my grace and forgiveness. If you will repent, you can take your place in full fellowship with my disciples." Who are his disciples? Many women. Ladies, listen to me. What would you do if you were a disciple of Jesus there around that crowd of people doing that? And Jesus is lovingly forgiving this woman, and she's filled with tears and she's brokenhearted. "Oh, I want to be forgiven. I want to repent." What would you women do? Tell me. Tell me what you'd do. I ain't going to go until you tell me. What would you do? Yeah, you would. Come on, ladies, won't you come up there and touch an untouchable. She's had men paw on her all her life. Oh, but the loving touch of a dear friend embraces her. We understand. We had demons cast out of us. You think you were bad? You're one of us. And Jesus said to her, he says, "Now, go, and from now on, sin no more." In the Greek, it reads like this: "Leave your life of sin behind you. Leave your," what do you call it? "Occupation. Leave that career behind you now. And then don't go back into that world." This guilty, law-breaking woman goes away justified and forgiven. Jesus places this dear woman in the care of his fellow women disciples. Now I want to make a personal note, just a comment. Let's talk about sexual sins here for just a little bit. Probably one of the most habitual problems that we have, at least in the United States, I know today. You can't turn on TV or go half a mile on a billboard. Come on now. You know what I'm saying? It's prevalent. It's all around. We used to get on to you boys about that, what do you call that, pornography addiction kind of thing? Did you know that women have now surpassed men in pornographic addiction? See? Now, come on now. We all understand this. Not you, of course. I'm not, you know. Well, I got to take the tension away from you a little bit here. Not you. You know what I'm saying? We all understand that. We all did that. Boy, and I'll tell you. Especially it is hard for the men, because a lot of times if you're a prostitute, you get exposed, right? But the men, boy, it's done a secret sin. Boy, something like that. Oh, nobody knows. Nobody. And then I don't have to, publicize it, or I don't have to get forgiven of that. You know, I'll just secretly put it off. But if you put it off, you get shame and guilt that just eat you up like cancer. Now then, I have had the privilege of sharing the gospel with many working girls. And I'm going to tell you, several here in this church. I give them the gospel. Boy, it breaks their heart. And they go, "You're kidding, Dave. Somebody could love me." Oh, yeah, I don't mean use you. I mean love me. Oh, yeah. Lord Jesus loves you, cares for you. I don't want anything from you. Oh, and they repent. And they say, "Boy, can I be forgiven?" Oh, I said, "Oh, yeah. Boy, you can be forgiven." And then I take them out there and I dunk them in the water out there, that Gulf of Mexico. Boy, I'll tell you what. There's not one yet that has ever gone back into the old lifestyle. See, that's the power of exposing sin and being forgiven. All right, that's my little. Let's get back to the lesson. Jesus now, we're done with the lady, right? And he turns to those who he has been teaching. Oh, and he said to them, "Look around you. Tell me, what do you see?" "Well, it's the Feast of Booths, Jesus, in the court of women." They had lanterns hanging from the court of women during this great Feast of Booths. And it's like these lanterns up here that Father Ralph, the founder of our church 72 years ago, he carved these lanterns, we call them, up here. They're as light as balsa wood is light. And they've been up hanging up here in this temple, you know, this church house here for all these years. I hate it when I got to get up there and unscrew one of those things and put it in. Oh, boy, there's light everywhere. People are lighting torches in the courtyard of the women. And the Levitical priests have brought out their musical instruments. And they're playing like the band here is playing. Oh, they're just playing. And they're singing and there's dancing and there's praising God. That's what's going on. That's what that woman faced after she faced Jesus. Joyous praise and worship of God. Now watch this. Jesus, at this moment, this is verse 12. And I'm going to say it the way it is, not the way it's written. And Jesus joyfully cries out and he says, "Whoo!" He says, "I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will not walk in darkness, but will have light of eternal life." And everybody boogies down. Party. Yo, yo, what up? Let's do it. Get down. Come on now. Whatever y'all do, I don't know. We in Texas say we have a hoedown, you know, and we have a barn dance or something. It's kind of fun. All right, here's a question. Let's see if we can pick up a little wisdom from our story today. What do you do when you're a witness to some crime, violation, sinful, something that's overtly deliberate, kind of really, really sinful? What, you ever been a witness to something like that? There's a question. Dave, what do we do biblically? Well, the first thing you do is you never go to the person. You go to the Lord first before you ever go to the person. Well, let me tell you about how not to come before the Lord. Don't you come with arrogant pride, with some kind of personal self-righteousness, or be all incensed with another person's violation, demanding the full penalty of the law thrown on them. Yeah, that'll teach them. Yeah, that'll straighten them out. Yeah, that'll fix them. Yeah, we'll purge the evil from our midst. Yeah, I'm going to tell you. Let me tell you how to come before Jesus. You come humbly, full of conviction of your own sinful behavior and brokenness. You come with an attitude like that. You examine your own personal convictions, attitudes, and motivations. You get the log out of your eye before you ever try to get the speck out of somebody else's eye. And then second, now you come to the individual. Yes, you do. And I say, you come with Scripture. And with Scripture, I refer to law and gospel. The law, the Ten Commandments, that's a law, right? Anybody in here been able to keep all Ten Commandments? Well, Scripture says if you violate one, you're guilty of all of them. Okay, you do bring the law. This is the Word of God. This is true. This is good. Jesus said, not one iota of the law will ever be excused as long as I'm here. I'm here to tell you I've kept the law perfectly. You can't, I can. We bring the law, and we also bring the gospel. And you remember that Scripture judges not me. Well, thus saith Dave, this is what Dave thinks. No, no, no. This is what the Scriptures teach. And what I mean by law, I say that when a sinful act is committed, you do not turn a blind eye or wink at sin. You confront it. And you confront it with the gospel, because the whole purpose is to have godly restoration. You confront them. You speak the truth in love to them. You come with humility, and it takes courage. You come privately. You come personally. This is what we call the Matthew 18 principle. It's Matthew, y'all write this down, stick it in your head, go home with it. It's Matthew 18, verse 15. Matthew 18, 15. If your brother sins, go and show him his fault in private. You talk to anybody else. And if he listens to you, you have won a brother. This must be a private conversation. I'm going to tell you, some of the worst gossip takes place in prayer chains. If a believer does not repent, Dave, what do we do? That's between them and God. You see, if they refuse to repent, they are, in essence, they are demanding to be treated according to the law. They are rejecting grace, mercy, forgiveness, restoration. And I'm talking about people who have heard the gospel and say, I don't believe in that stuff. Whatever. They hear the gospel and they totally turn around and reject it. Our goal in this is to always intercede and love others into the arms of Jesus so that they may have a private conversation. Plus no one. When's the last time you had a private conversation? You know what I'm talking about. Put that off. Don't deal with that. Don't discuss it. First of all, it ain't nobody's business. You and God take care of that. Now, you need some help, come up to my place. We'll have a coffee. And I'll love you, and I'll show you the Scriptures and show you how God loves you and what have you and expose that. And boy, and we'll get rid of that old habit. We'll get done with that. Don't misunderstand me. That happens all the time up in my office. They think they're just having a coffee. We're dealing with something rooted down deep inside. When's the last time you had a private conversation with the Holy Spirit? What did He say to you? What did He ask you? What did He teach you? What did He want you to do? Talk to Him. Listen to Him. Amen. That's the Bible story for today. Band, come on back up here. Y'all are going to sing with us. Now, y'all didn't... Oh, thank you, Frankie. I owe Frankie money, and he's doing that, so I'll give him some money. You know how it is.
Be sure to sing really loud now.
We're going to play some more. Stay with us. Whoa. Oh, God loves you. Now go in peace. Have a wonderful week. The Lord loves you. See ya.